HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Murdered Midas, A Millionaire, His Gold Mine, and A Strange Death on an Island Paradise by Charlotte Gray. Read by Stephen Graybill. Introduction. A corpse is open to all comers. Nassau, the Bahamas, July 8, 1943. The battered and burned body sprawled across the bed's blood-soaked covers, face up, with bare feet hanging over the edge. The victim's skull bore 4 puncture marks above his left ear, and his face was smeared with blood. There were bloodstains on the wall and rusty drops and pools of dried blood on the carpet. On the night table next to the bed, a set of false teeth sat in a glass of water. Someone had deliberately set a fire, and the odor of scorched fabric and charred flesh lingered in the air of the second-floor bedroom. The mosquito net had been incinerated, the sheets and covers were burned, patches of the carpet were singed, and both a nearby Chinese screen and the door to the hallway bore scorch marks. In the next-door bathroom, there were black cinders on the floor and burnt material in the wash basin. A pillow had been ripped open, and a fan that whirred quietly had blown feathers around. Some floated in the hot, sticky air, while others clung to the charred corpse or settled lazily next to the false teeth and foot powder on the bedside table. The police report described the grisly murder scene on the Bahamian island of New Providence, but each detail raised questions. What was the weapon that had made the 4 strange angular puncture marks? Why did it appear as though blood from the wounds had flowed uphill towards the nose? Had the body been turned to lie face up? Were the bloodstains on the wall handprints? Did the blood on the floor mean there had been a fight? When the murderer tried to burn the body, why hadn't the bedding gone up in flames or the fire engulfed the rest of the room? How many murderers were there? Had the pillow been deliberately ripped? However, only one question really mattered. Who had done this? Who had killed Sir Harry Oakes, the owner of a Canadian gold mine, a man said to be worth over $200 million, an unusually large fortune back then, and equal to more than $3 billion in today's terms? All dollar figures in the text are Canadian, unless otherwise specified. Who had bludgeoned to death the mega-millionaire who was frequently described in the press as the richest man in the British Empire, or tagged as Midas, after the mythical Greek monarch who had the gift of turning everything he touched to gold? Who would want to murder the largest landholder and investor in the Bahamas and friend of the Duke of Windsor, the governor of the Bahamas? As the sea breeze from nearby Cable Beach dispersed the last traces of the mysterious fire in Westbourne, Sir Harry's bougainvillea-covered mansion, the news of his death surged across the English-speaking world to New York City, then across the Atlantic to London, the Imperial Center, and north to the remote Canadian mining town of Kirkland Lake in the Ontario bush. It would quickly become celebrated as the crime of the century. The murder of Sir Harry Oakes was committed over 7 decades ago in a colonial backwater, yet it continues to exert a dark appeal. Fascination persists because the one question that really mattered has never been answered. No murderer was brought to justice. But it is not only the lack of a neat resolution to this whodunit that grabs attention. There are additional layers of mystery. A member of the British royal family, the former King Edward VIII, was involved, and he took far too close an interest in how the murder was investigated. Then there are the recurrent mutterings about illegal financial transactions, mafia involvement, spy activities. Murder is always shocking, but this crime was committed at a time of raw nerves and global tension. While Sir Harry's life was cut short in a paradise of palm trees, turquoise seas and white sand beaches, thousands of much younger men were fighting and dying for their countries in Europe and the Far East. An added ingredient to this story is the glitter of Sir Harry's gold. Nothing brings out greed and suspicion faster than the image of a stack of gold bars. Where did the mine owner's fortune end up? Since the news of the multimillionaire's death first broke, suspicions about what might have happened have bloomed. The mythology of the murder has taken flight thanks to several true crime books, episodes in novels by writers including Timothy Findley and William Boyd, and movies with titles such as Passion in Paradise, 1983, starring Marlon Brando, Eureka, 1984, starring Gene Hackman, Passion and Paradise, 1989, starring Rod Steiger, and Murder in Paradise, 2010, with Gillian Anderson. So after all these treatments, several shamelessly sensationalist, as accounts of brutal murders tend to be, is there any more to say about Harry Oakes and his untimely end? I think there is. In contrast to the tsunami of ink and celluloid spent on his death, little has been written about his life. The murder victim is usually dismissed as an unpleasant man whose death caused few regrets. Few spoke up for Harry. His extraordinary achievement in striking gold, retaining control of his gold mine, and helping to establish Toronto as a center for the mining industry in the 1920s has been forgotten. The sinister friendships with pro-Nazi appeasers that he made in London during the 1930s, which probably secured his baronetcy and may have been a factor in his death, have been quietly obscured. The only connection with this crowd that is remembered today is his relationship with the Duke of Windsor. The person who should have been the leading suspect in his death was never properly investigated. Oakes's financial dealings have remained invisible. And there is a further aspect of the Harry Oakes story that deserves notice. Coverage of the crime soon shifted in tone. A matter of public interest slid into being of purely prurient interest. The articles, books, and movies that have explored the Oakes murder have built on each other, blatantly incorporating speculation as fact and personal bias as history. False facts litter this particular narrative, and those assertions have demonized Oakes while deflecting attention from the most obvious murder suspect, the man who stood to gain the most from Oakes's death. As a biographer, I know how easy it is to shape reputations posthumously. The tools are subtle adjustments, sly cuts, colorful embellishments, exaggeration. In the words of Jean-Paul Sartre, a corpse is open to all comers. And Sir Harry Oakes is the kind of man for whom few people shed a tear these days, a wealthy old white man who could treat people abominably. But his flaws were rooted in his early struggles to realize his ambitions and in his tenacious pursuit of a dream. Hardened by years of isolation and resentment, the former prospector was singularly unprepared for the sophisticated circles into which his immense wealth propelled him. Some people admired him as a hero and a benefactor. Others haughtily dismissed him as an uncouth bully. Only the latter image has survived in the popular imagination. So yes, I think there is more to say about Harry Oakes, who during his lifetime was both admired and reviled, but after his death was recalled only for his murder. A gruesome death that was increasingly interpreted as his just deserts. There is more to say about the identity of the man who was probably responsible for the murder, and how he evaded scrutiny. And there is more to say about the way that writers can skew the story, reframe events, and manipulate history to suit their own purposes. But let's start at the beginning. Part 1. Making It. Chapter 1. Roaming the Globe for Gold. He never stopped. Every morning he started at dawn, and he stopped when it was too dark to see. He did this 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. Leap year he worked an extra day. The memory we all had of Harry was of a little guy, broke, his bare ass sticking out of his pants because he couldn't afford to buy any more. Always working, always alone. A Canadian Prospector, 1947. Had Harry Oakes once again arrived too late for a big strike? In Toronto in the spring of 1911, The 36-year-old stared at the geological charts and topographical maps in Ontario's Department of Mines, noting the extensive grid of prospectors' claims superimposed on the region north of North Bay, bang in the center of the immense expanse of Canada. On paper, Northern Ontario looked as though government surveyors had already outlined its features and its potential. By now, the provincial bureaucrats suggested, the land had been tamed. Oakes traced with his stubby, stained finger the settlements strewn across the grim monotony of forest, rock, water, and muskeg swamp. The charts recorded only mining camps. The cartographers had ignored the numerous indigenous communities, although their presence showed up in the Ojibwe or Cree names of several features, such as Lake Temagami. Most of the network of links connecting mining camps consisted of rough, winding trails, but there were also newly laid railway tracks, punctuated at regular intervals by stations. The muscular little Yankee ignored the chatter of the engineers around him. He muttered to himself the names of the town sites that were roughly sketched around those stations: Osborne, Latchford, Cobalt, New Liskeard, Englehart, Cochrane. The Timiskaming and Northern Ontario Railway, begun 10 years earlier, drove the new mining boom in this region. As it slashed its way due north, it had opened up the sullen landscape of northeastern Ontario, west of the Ottawa River and Lake Timiskaming. But it appeared to Oakes that all the land around gold and silver strikes had been staked out by eager prospectors before his arrival. The government geologists told the newcomer that the best claims might already have gone, and that there had been few new mineral strikes. Recent claims were little more than moose pasture, as mining old-timers liked to say. Perhaps the Northern Ontario mining boom was slowing down. Wasn't that predictable, given the pattern of previous high-rolling mining booms? The 1848 California Gold Rush had tapered off by 1855. British Columbia's Caribou Gold Rush in the 1860s had lasted only 3 years. The Klondike Gold Rush of the 1890s was over before the century ended. Had Harry Oakes missed his chance again? Would he have to turn around and seek his fortune elsewhere, in South Africa, perhaps, where new veins were still being discovered? Harry Oakes's eyes remained fixed on the charts. As a youngster, he had reached the Klondike goldfields months after the excitement had peaked. Since then, he had been a Johnny-come-lately at gold rushes all over the globe, arriving after local prospectors had already staked the best ground. He had never been in the right place at the right time. Luck remains the key to most prospectors' success, so fortune had eluded him. But he had the bug. Wiry and determined, he was not easily discouraged. For Oakes, as for most of the thousands of prospectors who shared his quest, searching the wilderness for the elusive glint of precious ores was much more than a gamble on lady luck or an escape from the drudgery of urban life. It was an obsession, and Canada's vast northern landscape glittered with potential wealth. Oakes was a foot soldier in the army of drifters, fortune hunters, and prospectors roaming the globe in the period before the First World War. It was a time of change, but also a time of jarring disruptions, in a pattern that would repeat itself in the early 21st century. Technological breakthroughs were upending ways of life that had been settled for centuries. First the telegraph, then the telephone, and mass-market newspapers had revolutionized communications. Steamships, railways, and most recently automobiles had speeded up transportation systems and shrunk distances. Mechanization had vastly increased industrial production. Medicine was transformed by science. The nature of germs had been identified, and then aspirin and X-ray machines had been developed. Between 1880 and 1900, cities in the United States grew at a dramatic rate, by about 15 million people. Much of this flow of people consisted of immigrants from beyond American shores, but there was also a steady migration from rural North America. The Carnegies, Rockefellers, and Van Horns, who drove the Industrial Revolution, amassed immense fortunes, while ordinary Americans and Canadians found themselves uprooted, impoverished, and dispersed. The sense of dislocation accelerated when economies took a downswing in the early 1890s, so it is no wonder that, in the middle of all the upheaval, young men who were either unemployed, scratching out a living on tired old family farms, or stuck in badly paid office or factory jobs they hated, dreamed of escape and embraced get-rich-quick schemes. Walt Whitman had serenaded such an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.